Hey everyone, this is Kevin from thechesswebsite.com. Today we are in round two of our coverage, the 2017 Grand Prix in Geneva, the third leg of the Grand Prix circuit. There's four legs. Each of these competitors will be playing in three of those. But our competitors today, White's going to be played by Shakir Mamadatov. He is leading the entire Grand Prix. So he played the first two. This is his third leg of the Grand Prix. He's played in the first one, he tied for first. And in the last one, he got second place. So if you look at the leaderboard, he is at the top. So he's looking for a strong finish to go ahead and solidify himself as one of the top two finalists to move on to the Canada tournament. And he's been playing extremely well. He's moved up to worldwide rank of number six. He's got his rating at 2,800. So at 32 years old, he's playing the best chess of his life. His opponent, Ernesto, currently 43rd in the world. He's only played one leg of the Grand Prix so far. That was the last one, and he did place last. So we kind of have two spectrums here as far as players, but without further ado, we will go ahead and get started. Shakir starts out with pawn to d4, knight f6, knight f3, pawn d5, pawn up here c4, and then pawn e6. So we got into the Queen's Gambit Decline yesterday, and we're going to be treated by another Queen's Gambit Decline line today as well. Now in round one, we saw the knight coming out to c3 early on. We do not see that from White today. Instead, bishop's going to be coming out here to g5. Later on, can solidify with pawn to e3 since it's outside the pawn chain. But this does open up the door for the bishop to come down here to b4, kind of with that Nimzo Indian defense that you see a lot of times. That's before the pawn comes up here to d5. But that's why so many players will play this knight up here to c3 first, so they don't have to worry about the bishop coming down here to b4. And then if a knight to c3, what they'd like to play, and then you have an exchange here, double pawns on the c file. So a lot of players will just try to avoid those lines at all possible. But in here we see knight to d2 instead, and then the pawn takes on c4. Now you may look at it and say, well, the queen could just come up here, check, take the bishop. But unfortunately, it gets a little tricky because just knight here to c6 protecting the bishop. Then you can see pawn here to e3, light square bishop attacking the pawn right here. But then bishop to d7. Bishop can't take here on c4 because then just knight takes on d4. This is a discovered attack on the bishop. So it's not quite as easy as it may look to go ahead and capture that bishop right here with the queen coming here to a4. So instead, without getting the queen involved into the game too early, decides to go and just play pawn here to e3, opening up the door for the light square to attack this. And black has a couple options here. You can try to hold on to that material, or he could decide to go ahead and just give that material back and then continue his development. He decides to go ahead and hold on to it, so pawn here to b5. White immediately responds back, trying to attack that critical square here that's protecting c4 with pawn up here to a4, and then pawn c6. This is kind of one of those, if you're going to play pawn to b5, you pretty much have to anticipate you're going to be playing this pawn to c6 next. And for White, this is where preparation really comes in. We're only on the eighth move of the game, but there's a lot of ways that White can kind of take this game. He could decide to go ahead and start taking here. Pawn takes on b5, start to have an exchange, open up this semi-open file for his rook to gain control. He could decide to go and play queen to c2. He could also decide to play pawn g3, fianchetto on the king side, castle on the king side. That's an option. He decides to go for bishop to e2. Protecting his knight here on f3 and then allowing himself to castle on the king side so he can then focus over here on the queen side. Doesn't look like too much is going to be going on the king side for a while just because black's putting so much pressure on the queen side. White really has to make sure that he doesn't get overloaded on that side of the board. Now knight here to d7. Can't really come here to c6 like he may want to, but does want to make sure he gets involved into the game. This more than likely means the bishop's going to be coming here to b7 at some point, get that light square bishop involved into the game. Castle on the king side, and then bishop here to b6. Now, for a long time, a standard play was just castle on the king side. You see white castle, black castles as well, and then you could see pawn here to b3. You could see the exchange. You could just see black continue to push. Pawn down here to c3, and then knight up here to e4. This was kind of the standard line. Black has now shifted more of to the queen to b6, kind of waiting to castle on the king side. Recognize he's not under pressure right now since his opponent's not really focused on the king side attack. So just tries to be more aggressive on the queen side. White plays queen to c2, continuing and completing his development, and then bishop to b7. This is a spot where if black wanted to, I think it makes sense to go and castle on the king side. His light square bishop is going to be blocked. The pawn on c6 hasn't moved. He could eventually move that if he wanted to, have a discovered attack on the knight here on f3, but does seem like a good opportunity to go and castle on the king side. He decides to go and play a bishop to b7, getting ready to kind of push forward with the pawn to c5, as we just discussed, but he will at some point need to have some king side safety. Now, pawn up to a b3, and black has kind of a nice little outpost for his pawn. We usually talk about outposts for minor pieces, but this has some great protection here and putting a lot of pressure on white. There's just not a lot of great squares for white to go to, having to worry about this pawn here on a c3. He does bring his knight back here to b1. Not the most aggressive square, but does need to kind of be aware of how he's going to maneuver around and kind of pick off this pawn here on c3. And then pawn to c5, looking to break up the center of the board, and then also preparing for the bishop to come down here and take on f3. White decides to go ahead and take back on c3, since he does have his queen protection here. And then pawn takes on d4, knight up takes on b5, and then the rook over here to c8. So we see an exchange on board, and then black takes the opportunity to go ahead and control this new open file on the c file. White plays queen to b2, attacking the center of the board here on d4, and then pawn to a6, forcing the knight to move, and then pawn to a5. So it says, okay, if you're going to attack my knight, that's fine. I'm going to attack your queen as well. We see the queen come down here to c5, and just on the surface, it may look like he's just basically moving his queen out of the way. He's being attacked and wants to have it more central in the board, but it's actually doing a lot more than that. The queen is now attacking both the knight and the bishop right here. The bishop is very key because the knight on f3 is the lone defender of the bishop right here. And if there's an exchange on board, let's say the bishop comes down here, takes on f3, then all of a sudden this bishop is kind of hanging out there, no longer has protection from the knight. So white can't make a mistake and play something like pawn to h3. This is going to be bad because then the bishop's going to come down here, take on f3. A simple response from here, if the bishop were to take, then the queen could take. He could either take the bishop here, he could take the knight over here. So those are all going to be bad for white. If instead decides to go ahead and take with his bishop here on f6, okay, well, the knight could take. We could see the bishop take, and then the queen's going to take here on b5. A lot of different options we could see, even if the bishop didn't take here. Maybe we were to see the pawn takes here on d4. Okay, well, queen over here to g5. This is just because the pawn came up here to h3, because this is forcing checkmate on g2. But after the bishop takes, queen takes over here on b5. Black is left with two minor pieces. White's left with one minor piece. So that's what white has to be aware of after the queen to c5. It's not just a simple move of I'm getting out of the way of your attack. It's a very strong attack against his opponent. From here, white has a few options. He could go ahead and take with his bishop on f6, have an exchange. He could just play pawn takes on d4. This does stop the bishop coming down here to f3, because then the queen's just going to fall, so that's going to be bad. Does stop it from there. Could also just play knight takes on d4. Probably a little bit weaker than the pawn taking, because it gets tricky for white as bishop down here, c3. This is forking the queen to the rook. Queen kind of has to move, and then he's going to lose his rook. That we do see an exchange on f6, but could come back here to c3. Maybe doesn't want to lose his double bishop pair. Pawn up here to b4, kind of an in-between move to get the queen to move back, but then bishop comes back here to h4. Both sides have their double bishop pair, but at the end of the day, black has two rooks as well. So I think all in all, this would be a better in-game for black, so that's not necessarily the line that white wants to go through. So he decides to go ahead and play pawn takes on d4. I think this is the right route to go with. And then queen over here to f5. And this is kind of tricky because the queen probably should have come back to e7, still protecting the bishop here on b4, but it's a little bit safer square. Also protects the knight here on f6, does have protection with his other knight. But what he probably doesn't realize is the queen over here to F5 is somewhat in danger. There's a lot of squares that he can no longer go to. He's kind of under attack here. And so white kind of looks at this and says, well, let's start to form an attack here, brings his bishop back here to D2 and says, hey, do you want to go ahead and exchange bishops? Black kind of looks at this, not really as a threat, brings his bishop back here to E7, which is fine. But then we see knight to C3. And Black kind of looks at it and says, now I'll take the opportunity to castle. Unfortunately, he really needs to be playing something else because the real threat is knight to h4. Because after Black castled on the king side, knight to h4 and the queen is lost. And you could look and say, there's a lot of squares the queen can go to. Yes, but all of them end up the queen falling. And Black just completely overlooked it afterwards. He just said he didn't realize how much pressure his queen was after. Or was under, and he kind of just thought his opponent was trying to trade off material, go towards the end game. Didn't realize that it was all leading up to this position. Could have easily just played something like knight to h5. Now the knight can't come to h4 because the bishop could take it here on h4. That at the end of the day would be, you know, great for Black. White would never do that. But instead decided to castle on the king side. Huge mistake. Had so many opportunities to castle on the king side. And so at the end of the day, White is victorious after a huge blunder from Black in kind of that middle getting into the end game. So if there's one player that's been running well and got the best of it in this one, it is Shakir, and he continues his dominance. So he kind of moves up the leaderboard and is in prime position to kind of have another huge, strong showing at the third leg of the Grand Prix here in Geneva. So we'll continue to keep watch on him. But thank you, everyone, for watching round 2, and we will see you again tomorrow for round 3.